Hi, it is I, Christopher. Did you like my pose? I was trying to showcase my growing facial hair. It's starting to get puffy. It grows uneven too. I just put in some beard oil so it might look a little glistening. It smells good. It's from L'Oreal. I always thought that was like women's makeup and stuff, but apparently they have men's stuff too, because women don't grow beards, not in my world or God's world. Well, not naturally. Some women have that hair growing problem, but like actual real born female XX women, not XY men, people. I better stop before I get in trouble. You know how it is with censorship these days. Anyway, I am back to continue reading Yehoshua. There was no J in Hebrew. It's a Yod. The letter Yod. Yod, He, Vav, He. That's Lord. It's the Tetragrammaton. We translate that to Lord. And it means self-existing one. I am that I am. So even J for Jesus. In the New Testament, it was I, Jesus. And in the King James Version, the original 1611 version of King James in English, there was no J there either. It was Jesus also. And it's interesting that Y for Jehovah is also makes the same sound as the I in the Greek, Jesus. Jesus. Jehovah. Yeshua. I don't know. Some useless knowledge. It's not really useless. I shouldn't say that. It's very important because it's God's name. And I don't mean to... that was the wrong wording. Just some information I shared with you. So the gospel, Jesus Christ, or Yeshua HaMashiach, is the Savior of the world. He is the Lamb of God, the final sacrifice who takes away the sin of the world, for all who would believe, repent, and believe in Him and follow Him. If we repent, turn from our wicked ways, and believe in Him, belief is not just a mental assent. Belief follows obedience, or belief is followed by obedience. So we're not saved because we walk a certain way, we behave a certain way, we talk a certain way. We're saved because we believe in Jesus, because of our faith and trust in Him and what He did. But we do have to turn. When He came, He preached the gospel. And when He shared the gospel, He shared about turning away from wickedness and doing what was right in God's eyes. The Sermon on the Mount is all about doing what is right and obeying Him. He said that if we obey Him and do what He says, we'll be like a wise person building our house on the rock. When the flood comes, we will stand. If we do not obey Him, we would be a foolish person building a house on sand. When the flood comes, it will fall. So, I don't know why I'm sharing that. Well, I guess because sometimes people preach grace in a way that isn't really what God means when he talks about grace, the gospel of grace. grace is giving us what we don't deserve, and that's his righteousness. Mercy is not giving us what we deserve, which is judgment and wrath. Because we all sin against God, we're all guilty before him, and we're worthy of eternal hellfire, of punishment for our sins against a holy God. He is perfect and just, and if we believe in him, we will obey him. And if we love him, we'll obey him. But no one is perfect. I'm not saying that we can be perfect. Jesus says to be perfect and to be holy. In his word, he tells us to. And if we trust in him and follow him, he'll make us that way. He changes us. He sanctifies us and makes us more like him every day that we walk with him and read his word and abide in him and allow the Holy Spirit, who we receive when we come into relationship with him, to change us into his image. If we abide in him and walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. If we don't walk in the Spirit, we walk in the works of the flesh. We won't be pleasing him. we will reap what we sow. We can do things in this life that are against what God wants us as believers, as Christians, and we can suffer the punishment for that. But that doesn't mean that we will be judged in the end. In the end, if we are one who practices righteousness rather than practicing lawlessness, even though we sometimes fall and sin, he is just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness if we confess those sins. And he is our propitiation, meaning that he bore the wrath of God against sin for us. And so he was fully man and fully God. He walked the earth, healed the sick, raised the dead, cast out devils. He raised up disciples and taught them to do the same things he did. Then he delivered himself up as a guilty man, even though he was perfect and holy. This is Jesus, Yeshua. And then he bore our sickness and pains on his body by being whipped, beaten, scourged, flesh torn off his body, mocked, abused by the Romans, rejected by the Jews. He delivered himself up for all that would believe in him. He came for that purpose. And then he was crucified, nailed to a cross by his hands and feet, and he died there. He was pierced in his side, and then he was buried in a grave and rose from the grave 3 days later, appeared to all his followers and over 500 people at one time. And then he ascended back to heaven for a time when he's soon to come back. Very close, very near, much nearer than when he first went up, because that was 2,000 years ago. And I think his return is very soon. I think I can't see us being here for 10 more years, but who knows? We'll see. And you don't know when you will pass away, when you breathe your last breath. The Bible says that is appointed to man to die once and then face judgment. If we die when we have Jesus as our Lord and Savior, if we put our trust in him, what he did by bearing our sin on the cross, his blood was shed to wipe away our sins, then we will not face judgment. We will not face the wrath of God. We will not be cast into hell. We will not be cast into the lake of fire. We will live forever with Jesus. We'll have eternal life. And we will have a relationship with God while we're still alive on the earth. And we'll be reconciled to God through faith in Jesus. And we'll have union and communion with the Father, the Holy Spirit, and with Jesus. But if we reject him, we disobey him, we say we believe in him, but we don't even follow him, in the end, we will face hell and an eternity in a lake of fire. there can be people who profess to be believers who really aren't, who are really children of the devil, and they will be judged because they never really knew God, never knew Jesus. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, there's ones who say, Lord, Lord, didn't we do many signs and wonders in your name, cast out devils, prophesy? And he'll say to them, depart from me, I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. So, yeah, that's the gospel. And I'm going to stop there because it gets too long. And I'm going to read Joshua chapter 6. There's so much more I could talk about, but I'll stop. Now, Jericho was securely shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king, and the mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all the men of war. You shall go all around the city once. This you shall do 6 days, and 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. But the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. It shall come to pass, when they make a long blast with the ram's horns, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout with a great shout. Then the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up, every man straight before him. Then Joshua, the son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, take up the Ark of the Covenant, and let 7 priests bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Ark of the Lord. And he said to the people, proceed and march around the city, and let him who is armed advance before the Ark of the Lord. So it was, when Joshua had spoken to the people, that the 7 priests bearing the 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord advanced and blew the trumpets, and the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord followed them, that the armed men went before the priests who blew the trumpets, and the rear guard came after the Ark, while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. Now Joshua had commanded the people, saying, you shall not shout or make any noise with your voice, nor shall a word proceed out of your mouth until the day I say to you, shout, then you shall shout. So he had the Ark of the Lord circle the city, going around it once. Then they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the Ark of the Lord. Then 7 priests bearing 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Ark of the Lord went on continually, and blew with the trumpets, and the armed men went before them, but the rear guard came after the Ark of the Lord, while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. And the 2nd day they marched around the city once and returned to the camp. So they did 6 days. But it came to pass on the 7th day that they rose early, about the dawning of the day, and marched around the city 7 times in the same manner. On that day only they marched around the city 7 times. And the 7th time it happened, when the priests blew the trumpets, that Joshua said to the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Now the city shall be doomed by the Lord to destruction, it and all who are in it. Only Rahab, the harlot, shall live, she and all who are with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. And you, by all means, abstain from the accursed things, lest you become accursed when you take of the accursed things, and make the camp of Israel a curse, and trouble it. But all the silver and gold, the vessels of bronze and iron, are consecrated to the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So the people shouted when the priests blew the trumpets. And it happened, when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat. Then the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, ox and sheep and donkey, with the edge of the sword. But Joshua had said to the two men who had spied out the city go into the harlot's house, and from there bring out the woman and all that she has, as you swore to her. And the young men who had been spies went in and brought out Rahab, her father, her mother, her brothers, and all that she had. So they brought out all her relatives and left them outside the camp of Israel. But they burned the city and all that was in it with fire. Only the silver and gold and the vessels of bronze and silver they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. And Joshua spared Rahab the harlot, her father's household, and all that she had. So she dwells in Israel to this day, because she hid the messengers whom Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. Then Joshua charged them at that time, saying, "Cursed be the man before the Lord who raises up and builds this city Jericho. He shall lay its foundations with his firstborn, and with his youngest he shall set up its gates." So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame spread throughout all the country. Joshua chapter 7. But the children of Israel committed a trespass regarding the accursed things, for Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed things, so the anger of the Lord burned against the children of Israel. Now Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Beth Aven, on the east side of Bethel, and spoke to them, saying, "Go up and spy out the country." So the men went up and spied out Ai. I don't know how to say it. I'll say Ai, just because it sounds cool. And they returned to Joshua and said to him, "Do not let all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and attack Ai. Do not weary all the people there, for the people of Ai are few." So about 3,000 men went up there from the people, but they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai struck down about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate as far as Shebarim, and struck them down on the descent before the hearts of the people melted and became like water. Therefore, the hearts of the people melted and became like water. Got phlegm in my throat. Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell to the earth on his face before the ark of the Lord until evening, he and the elders of Israel, and they put dust on their heads. And Joshua said, "Alas, Lord God, why have you brought this people over the Jordan at all to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us? Oh, that we had been content and dwelt on the other side of the Jordan. O Lord, what shall I say when Israel turns its back before its enemies? For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land will hear it and surround us and cut off our name from the earth. Then what will you do for your great name?" So the Lord said to Joshua, "Get up. What do you lie thus on your face? Or why do you lie thus on your face? Israel had sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them, for they have even taken some of the accursed things and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies, because they had become doomed to destruction. I will be with you. Neither will I be with you any more unless you destroy the accursed from among you. Get up, sanctify the people, and say, 'Sanctify yourselves for tomorrow, because thus says the Lord God of Israel, there is an accursed thing in your midst, O Israel. You cannot stand before your enemies until you take away the accursed thing from among you. In the morning, therefore, you shall be brought according to your tribes, and it shall be that the tribe which the Lord takes shall come according to families, and the family which the Lord takes shall come by households, and the household which the Lord takes shall come man by man. Then it shall be that he who is taken with the accursed thing shall be burned with fire, he and all that he has, because he has transgressed the covenant of the Lord, and because he has done a disgraceful thing in Israel. Now I know why I was sharing about that part about grace and walking obedient to the Lord. Thank you, Lord. See, it's right there in Joshua even. So Joshua rose up early in the morning and brought Israel by their tribes, and the tribe of Judah was taken. He brought the clan of Judah, and he took the families of the Zarahites, and he brought the family of the Zarahites man by man, and Zabdi was taken. Then he brought his household man by man, and Achin, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, was taken. Now Joshua said to Achan, "My son, I beg you, give glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession to him. And tell me now what you have done. Do not hide it from me." And Achan answered Joshua and said, "Indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and this is what I have done. When I saw among the spoils a beautiful Babylonian garment, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. And they are hidden in the earth in the midst of my tent with the silver under it." So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran to the tent, and there it was hidden in his tent with the silver under it. And they took them from the midst of the tent, brought them to Joshua and to all the children of Israel, and laid them out before the Lord. Then Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerah, the silver, the garment, the wedge of gold, his sons, his daughters, his oxen, his donkeys, his sheep, his tent, and all that he had, and they brought them to the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, "Why have you troubled us? The Lord will trouble you this day." So all Israel stoned him with stones, and they burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. Then they raised over him a great heap of stones, still there to this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Therefore the name of that place has been called the Valley of Achor to this day. Joshua chapter 8. Now the Lord said to Joshua, "Do not be afraid nor be dismayed. Take all the people of war with you and rise, go up to Ai. See, I have given into your hand the king of Ai, his people, his city, and his land. And you shall do to Ai and its king as you did to Jericho and its king. Only its spoil and its cattle you shall take as booty for yourselves. Lay an ambush for the city behind it." So Joshua arose, and all the people of war to go up against Ai. And Joshua chose 30,000 men of mighty men of valor, and sent them away by night. And he commanded them, saying, "Behold, you shall lie in ambush against the city, behind the city. Do not go very far from the city, but all of you be ready. Then I and all the people who are with me will approach the city, and it will come about when you come out against us as at the first, that we shall flee before them. For they will come out after us till we have drawn them from the city, for they will say they are fleeing before us as at the first. Therefore we will flee before them. Then you shall rise from the ambush and seize the city, for the Lord your God will deliver it into your hand. And it will be, when you have taken the city, that you shall set the city on fire. According to the commandment of the Lord you shall do. See, I have commanded you." Joshua therefore sent them out, and they went to lie in ambush, and stayed between Bethel and Ai, on the west side of Ai. But Joshua lodged that night among the people. Then Joshua rose up early in the morning and mustered the people, and went up, he and the elders of Israel, before the people of Ai. And all the people of war who were with him went up and drew near, and they came before the city and camped on the north side of Ai. Now a valley lay between them and Ai. So he took about 5,000 men and set them in an ambush between Bethel and Ai on the west side of the city. And when they had set the people, all the army that was on the north of the city and its rear guard on the west of the city, Joshua went that night into the midst of the valley. Now it happened, when the king of Ai saw it, that the men of the city hurried and rose early and went out against Israel to battle, he and all his people, at an appointed place before the plain. But he did not know that there was an ambush against him behind the city. And Joshua and all Israel made as if they were beaten before them and fled by the way of the wilderness. So all the people who were in Ai were called together to pursue them. And they pursued Joshua and were drawn away from the city. There was not a man left in Ai or Bethel who did not go out after Israel. So they left the city open and pursued Israel. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "Stretch out the spear that is in your hand toward Ai, for I will give it into your hand." And Joshua stretched out the spear that was in his hand toward the city. So those in ambush arose quickly out of their place. Then they ran as soon as he had stretched out his hand, and they entered the city and took it, and hurried to set the city on fire. And when the men of Ai looked behind them, they saw and beheld the smoke of the city ascended to heaven. So they had no power to flee this way or that way, and the people who had fled to the wilderness turned back on the pursuers. Now when Joshua and all Israel saw that the ambush had taken the city and that the smoke of the city ascended, they turned back and struck down the men of Ai. Then the elders came out of the city against them, so they were caught in the midst of Israel, some on this side and some on that side. And they struck them down, so that they let none of them remain or escape. But the king of Ai they took alive and brought him to Joshua. And it came to pass, when Israel had made an end of slaying all the inhabitants of Ai in the field, in the wilderness where they pursued them, and when they all had fallen by the edge of the sword until they were consumed, that all the Israelites returned to Ai and struck it with the edge of the sword. So it was that all who fell that day, both men and women, were 12,000, all the people of Ai. For Joshua did not draw back his hand with which he stretched out the spear until he had utterly destroyed all the inhabitants of Ai. Only the livestock and the spoil of that city Israel took as booty for themselves, according to the word of the Lord which he had commanded Joshua. So Joshua burned Ai and made it a heap forever, a desolation to this day. And the king of Ai he hanged on a tree until evening. And as soon as the city was down, Joshua commanded that they should take his corpse down from the tree, cast it at the entrance of the gate of the city, and raise over it a great heap of stones that remains to this day. Now Joshua built an altar to the Lord God of Israel in Mount Ebal, as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded the children of Israel, as it is written in the book of the law of Moses, an altar of whole stones, over which no man has wielded an iron tool, and they offered on it burnt offerings to the Lord, and sacrificed peace offerings. And there, in the presence of the children of Israel, he wrote on the stones a copy of the law of Moses, which he had written. Then all Israel, with their elders and officers and judges, stood on either side of the ark before the priests, the Levites, who bore the ark of the covenant of the Lord, the strangers as well as he who was born among them. Half of them were in front of Mount Gerizim, and half of them in front of Mount Ebal, as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded before, that they should bless the people of Israel. And afterward he read all the words of the law, the blessings and the cursings, according to all that is written in the book of the law. this was not a word of all that Moses had commanded, which Joshua did not, or there was not a word of all that Moses had commanded, which Joshua did not read before all the assembly of Israel, with the women, the little ones, and the strangers who were living among them. Joshua chapter 9. And it came to pass, when all the kings who were on this side of the Jordan, in the hills and in the lowlands and in all the coasts of the great sea toward Lebanon, the Hittite, the Amorite, the Canaanite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, and the Jebusite heard about it, that they gathered together to fight with Joshua and Israel with one accord. See, there's that Honda. But when the inhabitants of Gibeon heard what Joshua had done to Jericho and Ai, they were worked craftily and went and pretended to be ambassadors. And they took old sacks on their donkeys, old wineskins torn and mended, old and patched sandals on their feet, and old garments on themselves, and all the bread of their provision was dry and moldy. And they went to Joshua, to the camp at Gilgal, and said to him, and to the men of Israel, "We have come from a far country. Now therefore make a covenant with us." Then the men of Israel said to the Hivites, "Perhaps you dwell among us. So how can we make a covenant with you?" But they said to Joshua, "We are your servants." And Joshua said to them, "Who are you, and where do you come from?" So they said to him, "From a very far country your servants have come, because of the name of the Lord your God, for we have heard of his fame, and all that he did in Egypt, and all that he did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon king of Heshbon, and Og king of Bashan, who was at Ashtaroth. Therefore our elders and all the inhabitants of our country spoke to us, saying, 'Take provisions with you for the journey, and go to meet them, and say to them, "We are your servants. Now therefore, make a covenant with us. This bread of ours we took hot for our provision from our houses on the day we departed to come to you. But now, look, it is dry and moldy. And these wineskins which we filled were new, and see, they are torn. And these our garments and our sandals have become old because of the very long journey.' Then the men of Israel took some of their provisions, but they did not ask counsel of the Lord. So Joshua made peace with them and made a covenant with them to let them live. And the rulers of the congregation swore to them. And it happened at the end of 3 days, after they had made a covenant with them, that they heard that they were their neighbors who dwelt near them. Then the children of Israel journeyed and came to their cities on the third day. Now their cities were Gibeon, Chephirath, Beeroth, and Kiriath Jearim. But the children of Israel did not attack them, because the rulers of the congregation had sworn to them by the Lord God of Israel, and all the congregation complained against the rulers. Then all the rulers said to all the congregation, "We have sworn to them by the Lord God of Israel. Now therefore we may not touch them. This we will do to them. We will let them live, lest wrath be upon us because of the oath which we swore to them." And the elders said to them, "Let them live, but let them be woodcutters and water carriers for all the congregation, as the rulers had promised them." Then Joshua called for them, and he spoke to them, saying, "Why have you deceived us, saying, 'We are very far from you,' when you dwell near us? Now therefore you are cursed, and none of you shall be freed from being slaves, woodcutters and water carriers for the house of my God." So they answered Joshua and said, "Because your servants were clearly told that the Lord your God commanded his servant Moses to give you all the land and to bless all the inhabitants of the land from before you, therefore we were very much afraid for our lives because of you and have done this thing. And now here we are in your hands. Do with us as it seems good and right to do to us." So he did to them and delivered them out of the hand of the children of Israel, so that they did not kill them. And that day Joshua made them woodcutters and wood carriers for the congregation and for the altar of the Lord in the place which he would choose even to this day. So I'm going to stop there. And boy, that sure shows you how important it is to take counsel from God, from the Lord. Or you might make a mistake, make a vow, which we shouldn't do anyway. Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. And bind ourselves to something that we shouldn't because of our words. Or curse ourselves because we go against our word. Yeah, it's so important to obey the Lord. I've learned that in my life. He said things to me and I didn't listen, and I suffered the consequences for it. But he's merciful. Like when that Achan sinned against God and coveted the things of Jericho, and he confessed that he did it, but he suffered great wrath. God's anger burned against him, and his family suffered too. But in the new covenant, because of Jesus, because of what he did on the cross, his blood shed for our sins, those who trust in him, there is mercy and grace. In the Old Testament, in the law, it was placed to reveal to us our great need for the Savior, for Jesus. We can't be made righteous by the law. We can only be made righteous by faith in God, and trust in him and following him and abiding in him. And that's the gospel of grace. We can't continue in the sin that we do freely, practicing, following in that without repenting and turning away from that and to allow him to take it out of us. You fall, you get back up. You go to him. You fall, you get back up. You go to him. And do your best to turn from those things. And eventually they go from you. Yeah. So thank you for listening. If you'd like me to pray for you, reach out to me at lovesflame.com, the contact us tab, and I would be glad to pray for you. And yeah, yesterday I said that Moses was told to, I think I said it right, because in Exodus, Moses was told to strike the rock and God would be on it and split it. Then in Numbers, he was told to speak to the rock. But Moses, he didn't speak to it at all. He only struck the rock two times. And I think I said that right yesterday in the last part of the video. And also, I noticed too, when Joshua saw the commander of the armies of the Lord, who is Jesus, I believe, in pre-flesh, word made flesh, he told him to take off his sandal, for where his feet are, it is holy ground, off his foot. So he didn't say take off his sandals, off his feet. It was just one sandal and one foot. So I'm curious about that. I asked the Lord briefly, but I didn't really look into it or seek his counsel on that further. But I'm going to find out why he said to one foot. I'll look at when Moses saw the burning bush too, see what was said there. I can't remember. There was something else I said that was wrong too, and I can't remember what it was. I was going to mention it. But anyway, thank you for watching, and until next time, grace, peace, and love in Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you all. Bye.